has ever walked on the face of the earth. He got his wisdom from God. And he tries to give us some of that wisdom in his word. Proverbs, the 6th chapter, starting with verse 16.
Amen.
Got quite a bit to cover tonight, but God's going to help us through it.
Amen.
These 6 things does the Lord hate.
Yep.
Yea, 7 are an abomination unto him. You mean God hates? Yes, God don't hate people, but there's things that just get on the wrong side of God.
Yeah.
And we need to know what those things are so we don't go there.
Amen.
Glory to God. Here he goes. Verse 17, a proud look. Number 1, leading the thing that God hates the most is somebody that has that pride about them, who think they're somebody they're not. A proud look. Look who I am. Look what I've done, and I can do it better than you.
Uh-oh.
And when it says God hates it, it's talking about unless you change and come out of that, you're headed for hell. You're headed for destruction.
That's right.
That bad business, huh?
God hates.
Amen.
A proud look. A proud man or a proud woman. Proud upon themselves. A lying tongue. But Jeff, it's just a little bitty
white lie.
It won't hurt nobody.
Right.
God didn't distinguish white between white and black and lying. He said if it's lying, it's lying.
That's right.
Period. And God hates liars. God hates liars.
Hey.
I got to tell this lie just to make somebody feel better.
Yeah.
No, you tell them the truth.
Amen.
And let God worry about that. Because the truth will make them free.
I believe Sherry said that to others.
The truth will set them free. Amen. She said that. A proud look, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood. People read that, oh boy, I'm free from that. I ain't got no problem. I didn't go out and kill nobody.
But
it's not talking about just that. The Bible says, Jesus himself said, if you hate somebody, you committed murder to that person. So the shedding of innocent blood, amen, is sometimes with, for those of you, and there's many of you here that missed it this morning, we shed innocent blood for this thing right here, preacher. We shed innocent blood with this thing right here when we go demeaning the character of somebody else.
Right.
Saying falsehoods against somebody else.
Yeah.
Putting down somebody else, destroying their light of what they have going on, what they're, maybe even their testimony for Christ.
Right.
By putting that tongue out there, putting that word out there and destroying them through lies and deception. That's blood on your hands. You got blood on your hands. When Christ puts somebody in front of you and the Holy Spirit speaks to you and says you need the witness of that person, I want that person to become my child, and you say, well, I don't know how. I just can't do it. Let me turn the other way. I'll tell them another day. If that person never gets saved, blood is on your hands. Blood is on your hands if you don't open your mouth and say something to them about the Lord. Blood is on your hands with how you treat people. Sometimes come to church. I told you. Amen. And that's my sister in the back. I went to church one time with her. There was a young man to come to that church. Just got out of AA. Come in with shorts and a t-shirt on. And I told him to come and I said, sit right here by me. And the church was piercing him with their eyes. Look how misfit. Look how out of place. Man, that's just a sin. They ought to have been praying instead of looking at him and staring at him. They ought to have been praying that he would come to know Jesus Christ instead of staring at him like he didn't belong.
Yeah.
I tried everything I could to convince that man to sit there with me in the back of the church and let's just wait until the message got over. He felt so many So much knives is pointing at us. So much strife is coming at us. You don't look like us. You don't act like us. You're different than us. So much of that. They left the church, and I don't know to this day if that man ever got saved. My blood, but his blood ain't on my hands. But it may be on many of theirs.
Yeah.
Sounds nice about it.
The hands that shed innocent blood. 18. And heart that devises wicked imaginations. Wicked imaginations. Sometimes for some of you, teenage boys especially, you think, well, I can pull this plank and that plank. And it may scare them a little bit, but it's not really going to hurt them. Who do you suppose is wanting you to do damage to somebody? Wicked imagination. How can I get back at somebody? Wicked imaginations. Those that have that get back spirit. Wicked imaginations. How can I get the best? How can I get the upper hand? Even if I have to destroy this life to do it. Wicked imaginations. Wicked imaginations. God hates it. All these things God hates. Feet that be swift running to mischief.
Yeah.
I know growing up, that was one of the words they was in my day, just in the mischief.
Yeah.
Just in the mischief, in the no good.
Yeah.
How many of you look for the no good?
Yeah.
I don't want to go to church because I got to sit down and behave. If not, somebody get on to me. I want to be out there in the world where I can be up to no good.
Right.
Up to no good.
Why you got
to
change?
Yeah.
Feet that be running. Swift and running to mischief.
Yeah.
A false witness that speaks lies. A false witness. Again, destroying the character of somebody else because of your false witness.
Right.
And he who sows discord among brethren. You know anybody like that?
Yeah.
They come into a church and they want to sow discord and they want to tear up the house of God.
Yeah.
They'll get over here and say, Dre, man, I really like you. Uh-oh. You're a cool dude, boy. I like you. I'm glad that you come to church with me.
Lord,
you know that old Dre, all he does over there is sleeps and plays the drums and all he trying to stir up trouble. Trying to stir up trouble. Speaks out of both sides of the mouth.
Uh-huh.
You think it's just a little thing. God says he hates it.
Yeah.
And if God hates it, we ought to hate it.
Yeah.
We ought to hate it.
Oh, we're gonna wish we had.
So in discourse among church, I talked about it today. In Sunday school a little bit, that's how a lot of denominations got started. You see, when Jesus was here, it's just his church that followed him.
Right.
When they started out, it was just the people that followed him.
Right.
But as it grew, and people said, well, I can't worship the way they worship.
Yeah.
So they sowed discord.
Right.
Come on, can I get you and you and you and you, and y'all come with me, and we'll start us a new work.
Yeah.
Let's go get
it. Causing division.
Yeah.
Sowing discord. Be careful. Be careful of those.
That's it.
I've said it before many times. I'll say it again. If you got something you want to tell me about somebody, don't even bother. Just pass right on by me and go tell that somebody.
Right.
And if you got something against me, don't scatter it all over Facebook and all over whatever else goes on and all. I don't even know that Twitter and all that. Don't sit and do it all over that. Come tell me.
Amen.
Come tell me.
What
glory to God. So we don't have discord in God's house.
Amen.
Now I'm going to speak to you on some scriptures.
Yeah.
That actually has a double meaning, so you're going to need to listen good.
Yeah.
It means what it says, but it also means something else. Whenever God talks about a woman, he's talking about the church or a church.
Right.
Remember, if you doubt what I'm saying, remember that We are what? The bride of Christ. So when God talks about the bride, he's talking about the church. Now he's speaking here for a chapter and a half on an evil woman. And what he's really talking about, well, actually it is an evil woman that some of you young fellows need to watch out for. But he's also talking about a prostate or a church. A bad church. I'm trying to think of the name. Apostate. There you go. Apostate church. I got it right. Apostate church. Which is a church that claims like they know God. But they really don't. At least I woke some of y'all up, amen. I woke some of you up. Apostate church.
Put it out there, kill them. It took me a long time to book a box.
The apostate church means a church that is different. The church that doesn't serve Christ, but believe that they do. And you're right. How is it different? It's cancerous.
Yeah.
It's cancerous for a church to not want to serve Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
But listen to what he says here. He gives a warning. My son, keep your father's commandments and forsake not the law of your mother. Now these are mothers and fathers that teach you Christian teaching. You better hold on to them.
Yeah.
I know the young people are, oh, they old bogey. They don't know. We don't do it like that no more.
Yeah.
You better hold on to them.
Yeah.
Because they're trying to tell you the same way that about the same God they were taught about.
Yeah.
Bind them continually upon your heart and tie them to your neck. In other words, don't let go to them. Just want to say, hold on to them. Bind them continually to your heart. Keep them around your neck. Know what the teachings of God are.
Amen.
Amen. Too many times as young people, they'll get a little teaching in here, they'll say a little scripture there, and then when they get out in the world, they don't forget what they're supposed to carry with them. But know the teachings of God. Amen. Bind them continually around your neck. When you go, it shall lead you. Or when you go, it shall lead you. When you sleep, it shall keep you. And when you wake awake, it shall take with it shall talk with you.
Yeah.
In other words, you keep God so that when you sleep, or when you, let me do that again. When you go, it's going to lead you where you got to go.
That's right.
Many of us go the wrong path because we don't follow the word of God.
Yeah.
When you sleep, it's going to keep you safe.
Right.
But when you wake, it will talk to you.
Yeah.
I find this very word of God I'm talking to you about that talks to me. And there are times that I read it, and I guess any preacher here can tell you that. There's times when you read it and you just can't seem to draw a hill of beans out of it.
Uh-huh.
Don't make a lick of sense.
But
there are times when you get in it and the Spirit of God is trying to show you something and wake you up with something, it will jump off the page. And in your face, because it comes alive, and I feel the Spirit of God as I'm saying that. As the Word of God becomes alive, glory to God, that's all right, devil gone. The Word of God becomes alive in you, and it begins to wake you up, and you begin to see it as real life, not just a book anymore.
You tell when you step on this table.
Glory to God.
Wait a minute.
Devil don't like me, I'll put the microphone down and preach anything.
Amen.
Glory to God. So you need to have that to lead you, guide you, and direct you in life.
Right.
We have many questions. Where do I go? What do I do next?
Uh-huh.
Read the Word of God. I said the Word of God, and I told my young people this. I believe I told the church this. The Word of God has an answer for
everything.
Yeah.
Your relationship.
It ain't all about that.
Where you ought to live. Your career. Somewhere, somehow, the Word of God has an answer for everything. If you just put God to the test when you read it. All right. For the commandment is a lamp, and the law is a light, and reproof of instruction are the ways of life. To keep you from the evil woman, from the flattery of the tongue, and of a strange, the tongue of a strange woman. to keep you from that evil woman. And the evil woman ain't going to stay way over yonder away from you. She'll come right up to you. Ooh, Dre, you look handsome. And all the time thinking evil. Evil in the hearts. How can I get the best of you?
Hello?
You like
that. How can I get the best of you? I've experienced it. I know it.
Yes.
My wife back there, she can tell you. We was in Indiana. And I was working in a town called Gary, Indiana, and I was selling insurance, I believe, at the time.
Yeah.
And I got stopped at the red light. And to me, that seemed like the longest red light I was ever stopped at. There's a woman come up there. Hey, honey, can you take me for a ride?
Yeah.
No. Oh, I made it worth your while.
Yeah.
I made it worth your while if you just take me. No, all the time I went for this red light, just please take me. Just please take me. Oh, come on, baby. You know you're going to like it.
Hey, that's a
whoa.
Red light, God, what are you trying to do to me here? Get me out of here.
That must have been Michelle.
No. The reason I say that Michelle remembers the same time this was going on, she was on her knees praying for me. God told her to pray for your husband. He needs it right now. And she began to pray for me, not knowing why.
Yeah.
Finally, here come that dude in this three-piece suit that bring him. What's wrong with you, you old white honky? Why won't you take it? About that time, that white tank guy hit the gas and got out of there. Quick! It took long enough. But I finally got out of there.
Yeah.
I mean, it might have only took 2 minutes. It seemed like 20.
Yeah.
I just couldn't get out of there fast enough.
Right.
There's evil women out there.
Yeah.
And they will entice you. They will entice you. They'll bring you in. They'll do everything they can, to make you look at them and how beautiful they are. Now, before I go any further, let me translate that to the church that is not walking with God, because we have many of them here today. When you go in God's house, make sure it's the right God's house, not just in your church. The apostate church will look beautiful. It'll have all the new sounds. Honey, they'll put strobe lights if they think it'll draw. Put them disco lights and let you get up there and do the YMCA or something. They don't care if it's so they get you in. An apostate church will tell you lies and tell you that you can go to heaven no matter how you live.
Yeah.
And if you don't make it right the first time, that's all right. There's a little old red schoolhouse up there. Jesus gives you time to straighten it up once you die.
Yeah.
But my gospel tells me that as a tree falls, so shall it lay. Once you're gone, that's it. He said there's death only one time, and after death, judgment, that's it. And anybody that will tell you anything different is a lying scoundrel and a lying Turk and a lying preacher. Get ready for it.
That's right. That plain you can put
it. I told you about this woman last Sunday night, who is a Methodist minister. But she's also a lesbian. And she said, hey, Jesus realized he had to broaden his view a little bit.
Right.
Jesus realized that he had to accept this and that and the other.
Yeah.
Jesus realized he wanted to get along with everybody, so he showed love to everybody.
Uh-huh.
telling a lie straight from the pits of hell.
That's right.
To say that you're not of Jesus or you're not of God if you don't accept me being a minister. A woman lesbian up here. If you can't accept that, then you must be dense and dumb and just don't realize who your Jesus is. I mean, I know who my Jesus is. And he calls sin, sin. And he said, I am the same yesterday, today, and forever. I'll never change. And he don't change. So if you come to me preaching to me that God has somehow changed or that Jesus has somehow changed, you ain't done nothing but call a lie from the devil. Because I know my word says, Pastor, he'll never change. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He don't change. Don't come with his hog washing and telling it all over that Jesus has changed. That God has changed.
Yeah.
And now all of a sudden you can believe in Mohammed.
Right.
And use him as your Savior. You can still go to heaven. It's a bunch of hogwash from the pits of hell.
Right. We know that. We know that.
Glory to God.
Amen.
Amen. So he's talking in literal form. Men, watch out. If you're a man of God, watch out that women do not fool you with their pretty eyelashes.
Right.
And they're winking their eyeballs at you.
Right.
And they're walking with their little thing. Y'all can't see that.
Yeah.
Walking with that little, look at me now.
Like a flame.
Thinking they're going to attract you. Honey, they want you to go to hell, and I'll prove it to you by the end of this word.
Telling
you. Glory to God. To keep you from evil women, from the flattery of the tongue, and of strange women. Must not after her beauty and your heart. Ooh, ain't she good looking?
Oh, God.
She may be. But she's probably as rotten as she can be on the inside. That's what counts. Well, it's not after her beauty in her heart. Neither let her take care of you with her highly. For by means of a whorish woman, a man is brought to a piece of bread. You know what that means? That means you follow that woman long enough and she'll take you to the cleaners, honey. And you're brought to where you ain't got nothing to eat. But just that little piece, she'll take you to the clean.
Pack your bread back.
That's what that means. Ain't nothing. Won't leave you nothing but a piece of bread.
Yeah.
And the adulterers will hunt for the precious life. In other words, want to take your life straight from you. You think because you're a Christian that to use Bible terms, the whorish woman won't come chasing you?
Yeah.
They're the ones you want.
Yes.
Because they want to destroy. Satan wants to destroy your walk. And if he can't destroy your walk by getting you to do evil, he'll destroy your walk by putting a pretty thing in front of you. Can a man take fire in his bosom and his clothes not be burned? Can one go upon the hot coals and his feet not be burned? So when he goes to the neighbor's wife, now this is talking about adultery here.
Yeah.
So when he goes into his neighbor's wife, whosoever touches her shall not be innocent. Man, do not despise the thief. Now listen to how it explains this. Listen to how God explains this through Solomon. Man, do not despise the thief if he steals to satisfy his soul when he is hungry. What they're saying is that somebody steals from you because they're hungry and need food. And you find out that's really what it is, what do you say? All you have to do is ask.
Right.
If you ask, how to make sure you ate.
Right.
You ain't got to steal it. But if he be found, he shall restore sevenfold. He shall give all substances of his house.
Right.
But whoso commits adultery with a woman lacks understanding. You think you got it all together. You can sneak around. Get out before the husband comes home.
Yeah.
He who does it destroys his own soul.
That's right.
Stealing a piece of bread, stealing a bologna sandwich.
Think about it now.
I know why I'm celebrating.
Yeah, she mad about that.
I had somebody I knew very, very close to me come and took the TV out of my house, but he had time to make him a bologna sandwich to make sure he ate some of it and left throw it on the ground for a while. So stealing whatever, that can be replaced. But when you commit adultery, when you commit fornication, that's something that stays with you for the rest of your life.
And with everybody else too.
Stays with you for the rest of your life.
Like Channel 5.
Yeah.
That's why. There's such a big difference
in your faith
in that and any other thievery. Glory to God. Let me get on. Y'all didn't know the Bible had all this motherfucker. But whoso commits adultery with a woman lacks understanding. See, they think they can just do it, go home, forget about it, clean up, everything's all right. Ain't got to worry about it no more. You may clean up the outside, but the inside still knows the dirty thing you've
done.
That's what makes a difference. That's what I told you, the Bible talks about everything. If you just search it. He who does it destroys his own soul. A wound destroys his own soul. A wound and dishonor shall he get, and his reproach shall not be wiped away. You'll have that wound forever. You'll have dishonor. You know how you have dishonor? People be going around talking.
Yeah.
You know, them two, that boy, they needs, I saw him go in there after that, after her other mother. I saw those lines. I see.
Yeah.
And dishonor follows. That he did. And his reproach shall not be wiped away.
That's right.
For jealousy is the rage of a man. Therefore, he will not spare in the day of vengeance. For he will not regard any ransom. Neither will he rest content, though you give many gifts.
Yeah.
Once the man finds out, you can't buy him out.
Right.
He done stole his wife.
Yeah.
And you can't buy him out. It's the same thing with the church.
Right.
Bring it back to what I was telling you about. Yes, this is twofold. It's talking about our individual lives and how we treat one another, but it's talking about the church. God is a jealous God. The Word of God tells us that. Have no other gods before me. So how does this place in the church get? He's a jealous God. And therefore, when you go a whore to another church that don't believe in him and don't lift him up and don't praise his name and don't look for his glory, but your own vain glory or the preacher's glory or somebody else's glory, God is jealous. And he will be punished for his God. He'll have no other God. He won't have to lay second fiddle.
No.
Because you can go to the church somewhere and they allow you to do this thing and that thing. He won't play second fiddle. So you can go to a church and watch football on a Sunday night instead of listening to the message of God. He won't play second fiddle. So you can go to another church to meet women and men and hook up this way and that way and do it for anything before the pleasures of God. He won't play second fiddle. So you can go to another church and play honky-tonk music. He won't play second fiddle. To as one of my sons went to a church. And it was supposed to be a big thing for the youth, and they went to it. And where he met his wife, and I praise God that something good come out of it. But the night he went there, they had the Battle of the Bands. And they had a few bands that were supposed to be Christian bands. And a few bands that you know were worldly bands. All playing in God's church house. They were supposed to be in God's church house. And while that was going on, my son told me they had what was called a mosh pit.
What's a mosh pit?
Glad you asked. A mosh pit is when 4, 5, 6, 10 young strapping boys think they're the strongest thing in the world, and they get in the middle of this pit and fight till they throw the last one out and see who's the last one standing. They have this in the church house. Most people do anything to get you to come to their church. This pastor, myself, my brother, we ain't going to just do anything and preach anything up here to get you to come and say, oh, they preach so pretty. They preach so nice, they don't ever get it. Honey, if you ain't feeling some kind of conviction from time to time, let me tell you, you're either in the wrong church or you're tucked your spiritual ears up, because God says he chastens those whom he loves. If you go into a church and you never feel like you got a whooping, you're in the wrong church.
That's when the word is being
preached.
I talked, I had the privilege of talking to somebody, I'm not going to mention, but somebody in the church will know who I'm talking about. To a lady about going to church, and she said, I can't go to church because every time I go to church, all they're doing is condemning me. All I feel is condemnation and condemning me. Now, there's one of two things that is happening. Either it is a condemning church, like the one I told you about, where that man walked in and everybody looking at him. But number two, it could be God trying to get her attention. And the condemnation she feels isn't that of God, but is that she's brought on her own self and she won't repent of it. It could be one or the other. We need to know that we're in the right house of God. One that ain't trying to pretty itself up to get more souls in here. There ain't nothing wrong with getting the parking lot out here and having these nice things. Nothing wrong with that. Because then you're pretty, you know, pretty enough for God. But if you start bringing them TV sets and don't need to preach no more, you're going to let them watch TV.
Right.
Or you got it, I heard it. One place in Columbus, Georgia, God, man, they got TVs in the bathroom. You can sit there and go to the bathroom and watch what's going on in the church.
And see how they do it if you want to.
So you don't have to be a part of it.
That's
a part of church is fellowship.
I know it's right. That's the way we do it. That's the way we do it.
Stop it, but actually,
when you go to church, make sure you're going to church. That's going to tell you the truth.
We're praying. We're
heard or not. Heard
thank
him
you,
not.
God.
I'm a preacher.
Thanking you, God. You ain't God.
I'm a preacher, but I've had other preachers that have spoken at times. Brother, that's tanned my hide. Preacher, not that's tanned my hide. I had to get things right with God again.
Yeah, bro.
If you ain't never had your hide tanned by God,
oh, bro.
You're in the wrong church. Because God wants to straighten you up. God wants to straighten you up. I tell you, my sister, I hate saying anything when she's here because she's going to correct me. But she can tell you. Both of them probably can. Of course, Nina, she's almost down to the baby there. But whenever we done something wrong, he'd ask us who done it. And if we wouldn't tell on who done it, he just lined us all up. Make sure he got the right one. He liked to call it belt tea.
Yeah, belt tea party.
If you ever come to his house and you was a youngin' and he asked you if you want some belt tea, don't say yes. Because it'd be the last thing of belt tea you ever get. That was his kind of sheep party. Glory to God. But God thought so much of this subject of an apostate church, thought so much of a crooked church, that all of chapter 7, after what I just read, all of chapter 7 is still about that same kind of church. He thought of it this much. And this is why he warned his people. Go to the very last verse, chapter 7, verse 27. Verse 27, still talking about the evil woman.
Yeah.
Listen to me, fellas. Listen to me, church. Now, if you're a female, it still pertains to you as far as whether the church you fellowship with.
Right.
Her house, talking about the house of the evil woman.
Right.
Her house is the way to hell.
Right.
Going down in the chambers of death.
That's right.
Yeah.
When you hook up with that pretty girl that's flashing her eyes at you, you may think, man, I'm headed for a great time.
Yeah.
Let me ask you, where she's going to take you?
Right.
She ain't going to take me nowhere. I'm going to take her. I'm going to tell her. Oh, I'm going to tell her that time. Yeah, if you have to. You might even say that time, too. That woman ain't telling me what to do.
Yeah.
Let me tell you, young boys, they got their way.
That's right.
Especially if she's an evil woman.
Yeah.
But you follow her for her beauty. You follow her for her ease. You follow her for her softness. And eventually, when she figures she's got you,
yeah,
it turns around and drags you down. Mm-hmm. And it's the same thing with that church. Oh, man, I can go preacher. I'm going to go to such and such church. Man, I can go in there. And I ain't got to worry about they let me bring my pillow in there.
Yeah.
Just relax.
I'm
going to go to that church. Because they let me have coffee and donuts.
Yeah.
There you go. What they mad with us?
Y'all don't do that at that church.
All right.
Oh, man, they don't even have pews no more. They have tables set out. So you can sit out there and put your cocoa out there and your coffee out there and your donut and listen to the singing and the preaching. And when the lights go flashing, you can get up there and dance a little bit. And it's like, that ain't church. That's the honky-tonk.
Yeah.
That ain't church. That's the ballrooms. God's house is different.
That's right.
God's house is different. And we need to be different.
That's right, different.
You ask why the churches are looking down, not this year, but every church.
Yeah.
Every church. You ask why the real churches of God are looking down and not so swinging. It's because people found out they can play church a whole lot easier.
Right.
And they've been listening to the lies, amen, of those devils up there. Wolves and sheep's clothing, the Bible says. They listen to the lies of those devils that they're going to heaven anyhow. They might as well enjoy the trip.
Right.
I'm enjoying the trip too.
All right.
But I'm enjoying the trip knowing
Amen.
In whom I am believed.
Yeah.
I'm enjoying the trip knowing that he's in here.
Right.
I'm not enjoying the trip because there's going to be trouble. Sure, there's going to be trouble.
Yeah.
But I'm enjoying the trip because I know who my Jesus is.
That's right.
A lot of people are fools. I've talked to a lot of folks. They're thinking just doing good.
Uh-huh.
Or getting there. I talked to a lot of folks. They said, well, our church baptized this way or that way. Uh-huh. Our church does this or that, boy. Mm-hmm. And I'm in it every time they do it.
Yeah.
So I'm going to heaven.
Right.
No, you're doing a ritual. That ritual won't get you to heaven. Be careful, there's a lot of lies. A lot of lies. A lot of lies. Out there, y'all wonder why me and Jeff mentioned the name of some of these preachers. Because we want you to be careful and be aware of the lies. Out there. Serve God with the truth. And this. Not just what Brother Jerry says, not just what Brother Adam says. This is the truth. This is the truth. And anything that goes against that book goes against God and is trying to lead you in a strange path. It'll be very, very hard to get out of. I'm going to say this and then I'll close with this. Brandon and I have talked with a young lady on Facebook that goes to a church that has told her some mighty strange things that don't go along with the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
But she believes it's so thick that if you contradict her, you did it wrong.
Right.
You can show her in this book.
You can't show something.
Yeah. You can show her in this book. But she's going to say, well, our book it says such and such and so and so. I forget the name of that man that's over the Mormon church.
Joseph Smith.
Joseph Smith's his book says something else. And because Joseph Smith said that, that makes it right. So engulfed in that. It was very, very hard to get loose from those chains. Know this word of God. Do as it said, as I read earlier, tie it about your neck. Place it close to your heart.
Yeah.
Read it day in and day out when you get up, when you go to bed. Read that word, study that word, and feed on that word so that nobody can lead you astray. Nobody. I know people that are good preachers.
Yeah.
That have turned astray and some have led others astray. You look at Jim Jones. He was a Baptist preacher. I don't know how many of you know that. But he led people over in Gowanna somewhere, took them all the way out there so they could drink Kool-Aid and all kill themselves and die. Good preachers that turned sour and turned bad.
Yeah.
Be aware of what this word says.
It can happen to anybody.
It can happen to anybody. Everybody stand.
Yeah. Anybody.